everybody, and welcome to Encounter Roleplay. My name is Will, I'm a D&D sex icon, and I'm back today with the first episode of Call of Cthulhu Masks of Nyarlathotep. So, let's get into it, my friends. There's no time to waste, because the expedition is about to be afoot. So let's get around to cast and crew, let's remind ourselves of who we are, and of course, who we're going to be playing tonight. Let's begin today's session with Laugh Love Lindy. Wait, no, that's actually Greg. But don't worry, there he is. Greg Jack 21502, how's it going, my friend?
Oh, buddy, it's been a long, strange trip. And here we are, ready to make it longer and stranger as we get into Masks of Nyarlathotep. Chaosium's Call of Cthulhu, here with my pals, here with my family. Not my Cthulhu family, my family. And we are going to throw some dice, we are going to go crazy, and have fun doing it, as I will be playing foreign correspondent, Marcus Jordan.
Incredible. Of course, we have Lindy with us today. Lindy, how's it going?
Oh, it's going super spiffy. I'm quivering with excitement. I literally cannot contain myself right now. I cannot wait to begin this story. I will be playing Catherine Jordan, housewife, trophy wife extraordinaire, completely normal, nothing strange about her at all. No secrets, just lovely, lovely
normal
Irish
trophy wife.
Yeah.
Yeah, we'll see about that. Of course, we have redundant UK Tom with us tonight. Tom, how's it going, my friend?
It's going a lot better now that it's Wednesday and we get to play this. I have been waiting many, many weeks for this. And we've all got our characters and we're all ready and raring to go. Speaking of characters, I will be playing Dr. Lucian Ernest, an English doctor who's going out and looking for adventure and thrill. And also, just one more thing that I need to do. There we go. 26 months of pure unadulterated fun.
Amazing. Awesome stuff. Fantastic. And of course, we have Pruitt with us today. Pruitt, how's it going, my friend?
It's going great, Will. I am here live from the set of WebDM's new shoot. As soon as we get done here, I got to go shoot some shows. So this is going to be a great day for tabletop gaming. I'm excited to be back with this crew. I love these people so much, and to be able to get back into it the way we are. We're all here full tilt boogie. Everyone's dressed out. Everyone's green screened. Everyone's professional and ready to go. I will be playing Kaskov Romanovich, a Russian weapons dealer, and let's see what happens.
Let's do that. Amazing. And last but not least, we have Mr. Donovan Fry with us tonight. Don, how's it going, my friend?
Oh, I am great. I feel like I've been waiting for this game to start for so long. I'm so excited to be doing Masks of Nyarlathotep with these people, the best people to play Call of Cthulhu with every Wednesday. Love being here. And I'm excited to play a totally different character than the ones I've played so far. Tennessee Gray, a Hollywood stuntman and amateur explorer. I have no idea how we're all going to work together, but that's the fun part of Cthulhu, and that's the fun part of the first episode, too. I'm looking forward to that.
Absolutely. This is the where we'll be forged in fire together. A couple of things before we start today's campaign is that, of course, we're here sponsored today by Chaosium, so a big thank you to Chaosium for letting us do this show and playing through the official playthrough of Masks of Nyarlathotep. Aside from those guys, and definitely check out the new edition if you haven't yet gotten a chance. It's on PDF copy right now over at chaosium.com, and the hardback cover is coming soon. I'll also be showing off over the course of the campaign some of the beautiful props from the H.P. Lovecraft Society that go along with this campaign. And of course, we're sponsored, as per usual, by fancygrounds.com, our virtual tabletop of choice. Go over to their websites, check them out. The demo version is over there for free. WaylandGames.co.uk sell incredible board games, war games, and tabletop RPGs at up to 20% off. So go and check those guys out. Last but not least, every single game here on Encounter Roleplay, and at the end of this one, tabletoploot.com give away a set of dice here for you guys live in the chat. So stick around to the end of the game to be in for a chance to win some dice. You guys can interact with the show as per usual by retweeting this tweet. We've already hit a viewer decision. I know you guys are excited. When we hit 30 retweets, we'll get another one. And of course, you can subscribe to Affect the Game as well when we hit 5 subs. And last but not least, donate to Affect the Game by giving players Nat 1s, Nat 20s, Wild Magic Surges, and Leroy Jenkins. Pope has just given Koskov a magical item, which is one of his tattoos, which I have a fun idea for, because tattoos in Call of Cthulhu can get really, really fun. But I digress. We had our Session Zero last week. Definitely go and check that out on YouTube if you haven't gotten the chance. It'll inform you about some of the characters and about the story we're going to be telling. But we begin our campaign fresh, having done a previous playthrough of last, but this one is the official one where we're playing basically by the book with a couple of changes here and there. But for the most part, this is the experience you would have if you were playing through this book yourself. Now, our party are on an expedition. They have agreed to travel all the way to Peru because there is a gentleman named Larkin who is creating this expedition and searching for a long-lost pyramid somewhere in the Peruvian mountains, either for fame, wealth, or maybe some alternative reasons. The party have decided to come to Lima, which is the city where we begin our campaign. So, before we start, is everyone ready to begin this campaign?
Nah.
I think I'm ready. I'm getting ready. Yeah?
Yeah.
Is the chat ready? You guys in the chat ready for today's campaign? All right then. So, let's get into it. Now, our story begins in Lima. And we begin in a hot hotel. The flies are around here. It's so oppressively hot at this point in Bar Cordano, where the investigators have agreed to meet with one Augustus Larkin, who has made arrangements for them to stay at a hotel near here, and to meet him at the bar downstairs in their hotel, so that they can become acquainted with what this expedition is going to be. There are plenty of people at this bar. It's a busy evening as the sun is setting. But the first person that we see strolling into Bar Cordano is a gentleman in a suit. He has tattoos along his body, and he carries himself with a certain confidence. This is, of course, our good friend, Koskov. Koskov, do you want to remind us what you look like here and how you carry yourself?
Koskov walks in he is completely unconcerned with anything and everything around him. It's barely worth his notice. He's a man of business. He's a man that is powerfully built. Imagine kind of like a Tom Hardy build as far as just like general structure. Barely contained in his three-piece pinstripe suit. Tattoos adorn the backs of his hands and his neck. He's got a couple of heavy-looking rings on his fingers here. Most certainly, he's probably carrying a weapon if he himself is not the weapon. But he would stride in confidently, close-crop beard, and kind of belly up to the bar, have a look around, and order the vodka. Have to stay on brand.
There is no sign yet of the gentleman Augustus Larkin, who is said to meet you here at 7 p.m. For dinner, and any other expedition members. So you sit yourself down for a drink at the bar and make yourself comfortable here. It's not long, however, before several other potential expeditionaries enter into the scene. That is, of course, a couple walk in. Marcus and Catherine Jordan. You guys want to describe to us what you guys look like and how you enter into Bar Cordano?
Dear, go right ahead.
Oh, okay. Well, Catherine, she's about average height. She's got long, wavy, bright ginger hair, smattering of freckles across her face, and she'd be wearing a nice chiffon blouse with a bit more utilitarian skirt to kind of match the environment. Let it breathe because it's very hot here. Some pretty sturdy shoes to walk around in, but still a little fashionable. She has a gorgeous wedding ring, and she would be draped over the arm of her husband as they enter the room.
And as for Marcus, since he is in quote-unquote the field and he is a foreign correspondent, he would be wearing anything to take advantage of heat, or to use it to his advantage, I should say. So an open safari shirt, his hair usually swept back when in the presence of a potential employer or government official. Instead of it being, you know, slicked and parted for the day, it dangles loosely, damp with sweat. He looks like the pauper to the princess on his arm.
Amazing. As you guys enter, a waiter has actually come up towards you at this bar. They maybe avoided Koskov due to his outward appearance, but Marcus and Catherine, perhaps you were even recognized by this waiter. He comes up towards the two of you and says,
yes, can I help you? Need a table? Two?
Table? Fantastic. Yes.
That sounds lovely.
He smiles and says, not expecting anyone, are you?
Yeah. We're waiting for someone, my man. Augustus Larkin.
He smiles, recognizing the name. Oh, come over. This way. Follow. Koskov, you've overheard this conversation at the bar. And you see that the waiter is leading these two people over towards a more private booth in the restaurant floor.
Okay, yeah, Koskov will look at the bartender and motion for one more shot, down it, and then turn on heel and begin following them to the booth, wait for the waiter to walk away, and then kind of plop down in the nearest open seat.
All right. The waiter leads you guys over to this booth, which is set a little way away from the main restaurant floor. The restaurant itself, by the way, is tasteful. It looks like it specializes in seafood, simply but tastefully furnished. And you see sitting at the table at this booth, a hawkishly thin gentleman who's wearing a fine suit, has a look about him that is maybe a little pasty, maybe a little ill, possibly from the heat. He looks like he probably isn't acclimatizing too well to it. From this description that you'd have had, you can tell that this gentleman would be Augustus Larkin, the expeditionary leader who's brought you guys here. Next to him, there is a gentleman who does not look happy whatsoever. This man is similarly wearing a suit, but you can see just underneath the suit that he has tattoos as well. Not unlike Koskov's. They're possibly even criminal, you'd go as far as to say. And this man is well built, and has the complexion of a local Peruvian from here. There's a third gentleman who is seated at the table, who is a slightly older black gentleman who is wearing a hat, not just like the one that Don is wearing right now, and he is very smiley and happy to see you. As the waiter brings you over to the table, this young smiling man with the hat on greets you and is the first to reach out and shake a hand. And he says, Jesse Hughes, pleased to meet you. You must be Marcus and Catherine.
It's Marcus Jordan and my wife Catherine.
Oh. Hello.
Great. And he sees Koskov and says, Mr. Romanovich?
Please, you can call me Koskov.
Jesse Hughes. I'm not even leading this expedition. I'm sorry. And the scowls from Larkin and the gentleman sitting next to him speak to a rivalry or tension between the two parties. And Jesse kind of wipes some sweat from his forehead as he realizes that he's been a little bit maybe spoken out of place, and sits back down and says, "This is Mr. Larkin." And Larkin shoots up his hawkish narrow eyes towards the three of you. Yes, you're the ones that I've spoken to. Please take a seat. Apologies, the heat is, it doesn't sit so well with me.
You'll get used to it. Let it seep in.
It is not favorite weather. I miss my coat.
Yeah, he nods once, you'll notice the gentleman sitting next to him with the tattoos has been watching the three of you, sort of looking you up and down, assessing you, and particularly yourself, Koskov. And Larkin says, this is my compatriot here, Louis de Mendoza. And Louis grunts. He doesn't look too happy to see you.
It must be protection, no?
He grunts again, and Larkin says,
"Yes, there are a few folk who would say that traveling this far up into the Peruvian mountains would be dangerous, but let's wait for the others to get here before we discuss business. This is Jesse Hughes, a local folklorist."
Immediately, Jesse would strike you as not being local. But he nods enthusiastically and says, yes, I'm here to help as much as I can. And gives you all a winning smile. At this point, Lucien, you have arrived at the bar, at Bar Cordano. What do you look like and how do you make your entrance?
Okay, so Lucien is a fairly tall gentleman, but quite lean. He has short brown hair that has wisps of grey around the edges, around the sides, and a very neatly trimmed moustache decorates his top lip. I would say he's probably quite a handsome gentleman, and he seems very awkward. He enters and can clearly tell he's really suffering under the heat. Being used to the drizzle weather of England, this is quite extraordinary to him. He's looking around. He's quite clearly in unknown territory. So he's kind of playing with his hat and looking around, seeing if he finds anyone he can see or recognize.
Yeah, the waiter will quickly come and ask you if you have a reservation. You can give them the names, and he leads you over to a table where you will see Augustus Larkin, Louis de Mendoza, and Jesse Hughes, the three of which are introduced to you. And of course, Jesse, who seems to be the biggest speaker and the most friendly gentleman, as he goes and shakes your hands, will say, "This is Marcus and Catherine Jordan, and this is Koskov Romanovich."
Lucien will go over and offer his hand to shake. Pleasure to meet you. Absolute pleasure to meet you. Yes.
Nice.
Yes. Are we waiting for any more people?
Larkin says, "Just one more. Please take a seat."
Yes, jolly good, jolly good. Will do.
Dabs at his forehead. As you sit down, the last person who we're waiting for enters into the bar, which is, of course, Tennessee Gray. What does Tennessee look like?
So Tennessee is a couple inches shorter than the average man, but he's at a very athletic built, broad shoulders. He looks like he's been traveling, maybe even hiking that day. He's got a dark denim shirt that's, even though it's denim, still soaked with sweat. He's wearing a traveler hat, sort you'd see on safari maybe. And he looks like an all-American man, and maybe in his early 30s, except for he's got dark circles under his eyes, and it looks like maybe he's let his beard go a week and a half without shaving or trimming it, and it's starting to get a little fuzzy. He moves with a certain confidence, but there's a slight limp on the left side of his body. He walks with the aid of a cane, and this is a black, ornate looking cane with a head of a carved panther, and with a rap, 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 he strides over to the bar and he knocks his cane on the edge of the bar. He says, "Bartender, bartender, I'll have a gin and tonic. And please, hold the tonic."
He pulls you a gin and pushes it over towards you. He's seen a fair few interesting types come in from not around here, and he nods over towards the booth where you can see some other interesting looking fellows seated.
Tennessee's blue eyes flicker over towards the booth, and he recognizes that Larkin is there and there's some other seat there, and he nods his head to the bartender and he says, "You see, I got a toothache, and the doctor says gin is the only cure. Thank you, sir." And he slides him some money.
He smiles and grins as he takes your money. As you head over, Jesse Hughes is the first person to step up once again to introduce everyone. He says, "You must be Mr. Gray! Jesse Hughes, pleased to meet you."
"Jesse Hughes, good to meet you, sir. I'm Tennessee Gray. Good to meet all of you."
Yes. He goes around and performs the introductions of all of the people who are seated. And after a minute of that, Mr. Augustus Larkin, having at his forehead, says, Take a seat. "Please, Mr. Gray. And let's order something. Recommend the fish." Augustus insists on everyone having some food as you get seated at this long table, which is big enough for all of you to be seated at. Brings over some wine as well. And Larkin says, "Well, thank you all for joining me on this expedition. I think it's going to be very exciting indeed, though I'm sure you have some questions about the expedition itself, now that you're here in Lima, where we're going, what we'll be doing, that kind of thing. I thought it would be best to meet you all here so that we could run over the basics first."
"Where would you like a shipment of kitchen utensils delivered?"
"When we set out on the morrow, there is a staging area where all of the trucks and the like will be, so I think that would be best.
Good.
It's not far from this hotel."
"Nah. I will tell people."
"Very good."
He opens up the rest of the conversation as well and says,
"Anyone else? Anything they'd like to add? Or ask me. That was the best chance once we're on the road. We'll be exploring."
Absolutely. There is one or two things I need. Medical reasons, of course. Firstly, I would like a list of the known diseases and possible injuries that we could possibly sustain on this journey, so I could supply and get everything that's needed. And so if you could, you know, like such diseases, malaria, perhaps, or tetanus, or
the doctor, I leave that in your medical professional experience. Perhaps you could speak with one of the other local doctors, surgeries around here. Perhaps they could help.
Yes, of course. And is there anyone else before we go that would require a physical, or are there any illnesses that I should know about anyone at this table so I can monitor or maintain or anything at all?
No. What did I Very good. Aware of?
Very good, that's fine. Okay, that's me sorted. I'll have a look a word with the local doctors and see what they have to say.
Very good. Now, let me be clear. Our plan is to head up to the Highlands, locate the site of this lost pyramid, and recover some valuable artifacts. I have no doubt that with a team such as this, which I've assembled, we will have this done in no time. I first heard of the pyramid when I encountered a few interesting items near Puno from an alpaca farmer. Claimed his grandfather recovered them from a tunnel beneath a pyramid high up in the mountains. The grandfather never returned to the site because of superstitious fear, but he told his family there were other treasures in the tunnels. He couldn't give me a precise location, but he gave me a good idea of where to start looking. That's where we're going to start.
Now, excuse me for asking. I'm something of an amateur explorer myself, but what sort of artifacts are we hoping to find up there in that pyramid?
He goes into a breast pocket and puts two items down on the table and sort of pushes them across for you to look at. The first one is a pendant in the form of a man holding two rods or staves embellished with rectangular shapes. The second is a golden cup carved with geometrical patterns and circles and inlaid with turquoise. If anyone is any good at archaeology, you could give me an archaeology roll on the two of these.
I'll go ahead and make that roll. You want two separate rolls? Just one?
Just one roll is fine, yeah.
A regular success.
Yeah. This would indicate towards you that the two pieces are from distinctly different time periods and cultures. The first, the pendant, resembles some artifacts which were taken from Tiwanaku, probably dating back to the 5th century. And the second is of Incan design, probably dating to the 15th century. Tiwanaku is pre-Columbian, is a pre-Columbian site in Bolivia, close to the border of Peru.
Oh, Tennessee takes a look at these and he kind of turns them around and looks at some of the inscriptions and shapes, and he'll slide them back across the table to Larkin. Well, that certainly is fascinating. I'm not the foremost expert in South American archaeology, but I did study it in college, and what I can tell you is that, without a doubt, these two artifacts from the same temple, you said?
I believe so.
Well, they are from two entirely different time periods, one of them being as far as 1,000 years older than the other one. To find them both in the same location, well, that is something.
Well, we'll have to see what else the pyramid holds then. Perhaps it will be very interesting indeed. My research has led me to believe that there are something very interesting at this pyramid indeed. Perhaps it is a site where an ancient civilization collected such artifacts, not unlike ourselves.
And the face of Luis de Mendoza is, it kind of leans in a little bit as if to say, don't push this issue. And Jesse Hughes kind of nervously looks around.
Mr. Larkin, are you saying that you believe that there are some sort of evidence in that pyramid that there might have been an advanced civilization that predates our knowledge of the area?
Mr. Gray, I believe that we will find there something interesting, whatever it is we find. Perhaps you're right, and this is just a wild goose chase. Or perhaps there is something there deep within ancient Peru, which has been hiding for a long time. Either way, cause of science will be pushed forward, wouldn't you say?
Indeed. Well, cheers then. I'm excited to be here, and I'm glad that we have a doctor with us, because as you probably are aware, disease is the number one killer in these expeditions.
Of course. Now, is there anything else?
Marcus would chuckle at that, by the way.
How long will it take for us to journey to this place that we need to go?
With good travel conditions and a bit of good luck, we should be looking about a week up into the highlands. Oh. From there, it's anyone's guess. I would hope to be done within the month, at least to have found the pyramid, and then from there, expedition into a site such as that could take several more weeks or months, depending on what we find.
Interesting.
One thing that I would ask is that you keep this under your hats for now about where we're going. Some of the locals are superstitious about digging in sites and the like. Yes. I wouldn't want to upset anyone.
Yes, mum's the word, as they say.
Marcus would chuckle at that as well.
He smiles and says,
well, I've made arrangements for you at a hotel not far from here. I'm staying at Hotel España. So if you need me, then, well, I'll be seeing you at staging area outside Hotel España on the morrow. Unless there was anything else, I think I'm going to get an early night. The heat, it taxes me.
I can imagine. I'd like to speak with you privately.
As he kind of looks around at the others at the table.
He nods.
Very well.
And both he and stalking behind him, Louis, kind of walk out. And as you kind of walk out with them, Larkin will turn towards you as you're outside the bar.
Yes, Mr. Romanovich.
And Kaskov pulls out a picture from his pocket. It's of a young woman, fair hair and skin, beautiful, maybe just into her 20s.
I am looking for my sister, Stasha. She was staying in the area. I've not heard from her in some time. It is why I give personal touch to this deal we have. Could you help find?
I will do my best, Mr. Romanovich, and let you know what I found, if anything, on the morrow.
Yes, your man, he
kind of nodding back inside to the other man, Jesse.
Jesse Hughes? Yeah,
you say he's a local man, no?
Yes.
Could he help?
Perhaps. I wouldn't put too much credit in Mr. Hughes.
But you take him on mission?
He has been useful. And I think may yet be useful as well.
Well, perhaps I ask. But please, you hear anything, let me know.
And he kind of gives a pointed look at Mr. Mendoza, like sizing him up.
Yeah, he strikes you as someone that has a fair amount of strength to him. And you can tell by the sort of imprints in his jacket that he's carrying.
Well armed. Good.
And then he just kind of making that observation, turns and walks back into the bar.
Yes, as you return, Jesse Hughes has like taken off his hat and said, "Would you mind if we all have another drink? Get to know each other before the expedition."
Well, I think that's fine idea.
Indeed, that's an absolute capital idea.
Bye-bye. Please, I want to know who I travel with.
Yes, yes. As he looks around to the booth to see that Larkin and Mendoza have left, and he then leans in as the drinks come and says, how much of all of this are we believing here?
I believe money that Larkin pay me. It's real, it spins.
I believe yes. We're going on an expedition.
That we are. His belief doesn't really matter. It's just, like my friend over here said, it's all about the money. Money seems good.
Right. Well, you see, a couple of things. I've done a little bit of research on the matter. He leans in again. My real name isn't even Jesse Hughes.
You're still pleased by this.
And he drops the accent and says, my name is Jackson Elias. I'm a researcher, and I've done a little bit of looking into Mr. Larkin. I don't trust some of the things he's been saying. You know, I asked some of the locals, and previously Mr. Larkin has tried to convince some of the locals in Puno to explore the pyramid, but he was unable to find anyone willing to accompany him, except for a couple of people. A guy and a girl went out there with him, didn't come back. And he's come back here into Lima asking other people to come with him. Don't you think that's a little weird?
So he take, but not return. Why should this bother us? It's dangerous, you know?
Yeah, it sounds like that he was ill-prepared the first time, so he's given it another go and much more prepared this time.
Who did he take?
I don't know. Some guy and a girl, not from around here. Two of them went out there with him on De Mendoza and didn't come back. You know, there's another thing as well. Professor Nemesio Sanchez of the National University of San Marcos, which isn't far from here. You can go speak to him yourself. He's interested in joining the expedition, but Larkin has ignored him. And this guy, he knows more about the archaeology of this area than anyone else. Sanchez is a real professional. Sanchez even thinks he's got some old documents and artifacts related to the site at his university, but Larkin won't even hear him out. I'm due to see him tomorrow before we go out on the expedition. Maybe you guys would want to come along, see for yourselves. I just don't want to be led into any kind of danger by this creepy guy.
Absolutely.
I've been doing a lot of research about cultists and activities and that kind of thing. And, you know, this place here, Peru, it's a hot spot. People believe in all kinds of crazy shit around here.
Humorous, my man. What do you mean by crazy shit?
Oh. I've been, spending some time traveling around Lake Titicaca, looking for evidence around there, and I found what I believe to be a centuries-old death cult. Now these guys, they very much believe in death as being a way of celebration. They celebrate it by killing people. Pretty barbaric ritual rites.
A resplendent offering.
Thank you so much, Latu. And thank you for Dave. He's given everyone nat 20s as well from a mysterious friend. Thank you, Latu. But yeah, he leans in and says, these guys, now they actually believe that they are thanking their gods, praising some ancient creatures by doing this kind of thing. Now, I'm not saying that Larkin is into any kind of that, but maybe the Mendoza. I'm just saying. Good to be cautious.
So, if you would excuse, so what is your role in all of this? You say you're a local guide, yes? Or
folklorist. Basically, I know some of the stories and tales from this kind of area.
How long have you been here?
Oh, I've been in Peru for about 3 months, doing the research down at Lake Titicaca. Now I'm here. But I've traveled all over. I'm particularly interested in the occult. You know, Percy Fawcett? That light guy? Yeah.
I've heard the name.
Yeah, he consulted with me before he left on his expedition. So, I know a thing or two about the occult.
Well, I can't see any reason why we don't go and visit this Professor Mendoza. Or Sanchez, what was his name?
Professor Sanchez. Yes. Yeah, Sanchez. Mizio's first name.
Now, I don't want to get dragged into any conspiracy theories, and I'm not discrediting what you're saying, Jackson. Jesse. But I can't see any harm in talking to the professor and at least hearing him out, finding out what he might know. But we are all going with Larkin tomorrow, yes? All of us?
Right.
That's his plan.
Absolutely.
Marcus would share a glance with Catherine.
Yes, of course we're all going.
Well, as we're all here getting acquainted with one another and all that stuff, perhaps we should put forward what we bring to the table and you know, what their role in the expedition is, yes?
You are a doctor.
Yep. That's right, yes. I am a doctor. I am here to ensure that everyone is tickety-boo and nothing goes wrong. So please, if there are any ailments that I should know about, please let me know. We can do it in private, so it won't get embarrassing. But I strongly recommend you tell me about anything that I should know about your health.
Well, Doctor, I do have a little bit of a bum leg. It's recovering slowly, but it shouldn't slow us down at all on the expedition. I think you should be most concerned about our Mr. Larkin there. He did not seem like he was doing well. Some sort of cold or something.
Yes, he did seem somewhat unwell. But unless he comes forward and asks for some medical attention, there is little I can do. So we shall wait and see, but I will keep an eye on him. Rest assured, I will keep an eye on him. So what about the rest of you? Why are you here? What do you bring to the table, as they say? Please, don't all shout at once.
Well, Doc, we're Marcus Jordan. I am the founder of the Feast. My wife and I are missionaries. We are able to come in here to Peru, my men, and we're in charge of the paperwork.
Jordan.
There's an awful lot of paperwork.
Hey, why does Jordan ring a bell?
Done.
Oh, perhaps we met you at one of the community dinners, the banquets that they have for, you know, mission relief in places.
Quite possibly. There are one or two that I've been to, or one or another, but there are so many faces at those soirees that it's always hard to remember everything.
That's such a blur.
Yes, indeed. Particularly if you've had one too many drinks. you two gentlemen, what do you bring to the table?
Well, my name is Kaskov Romanovich. I will be helping with, how you say, protection. I will keep you safe from all things, not disease. And if memory serves,
he kind of like looks over at Tennessee.
This man is Tennessee. Is it Gray? You still
That's
trying
right. Tennessee
to save
Gray.
World?
Oh, in one way or another. I can vouch for Mr. Romanovich. He is very good at providing protection. Well, I'm here, funnily enough, on the trail of a certain Percy Fawcett. Our friend Jesse here mentioned his name already. I believe, like Percy does, that there is evidence that there were advanced civilizations before Western society, that the indigenous cultures of South America may actually be the remnants of these advanced civilizations. Now, imagine that, a world where...
Yeah, you can tell that Elias is... So, you know, like, he's upset by this. I don't know about that, Mr. Gray. Percy was a bit of a fantasist. I haven't seen much evidence to lead me to believe that.
Percy Gray is the finest explorer of a generation. He's captured the imagination of millions across the globe. Now, I understand that you might not agree with his beliefs, Mr. Elias, but you have your own beliefs that I find a little hard to believe myself. The great thing about this expedition is we can all go up there together and see for ourselves what is in that pyramid.
Yes, yes. The thirst for exploration, absolutely. That is what we're here for, yes? And the payday, of course.
And how
of
many
course.
Expeditions have you gone on, Monsieur Doctor?
None, this is my first. This is my first. Very excited.
I'm sure they'll do well.
Yes, I hope so too. I will listen to all advice that everyone has to give me. Is there
you
any advice
shoot,
that... Yes, I do. I have my own pistol, yes, my revolver from my time during the Great War, yes. Is there any other advice you would like to give me? Ideally, I'd like to keep all the fighting and the rough and tumble stuff to yourself, but needs must, of course.
Avoid the water, Doctor.
Oh, yeah.
I understand that's where most of the disease and nastier critters out there lie.
Oh, absolutely. There are many, many diseases and disgusting little insects in the water that just can't wait to get inside your body and make my life a living hell.
How reassuring.
Quite.
Yes, Jackson Elias will say, all right, well, I'm gonna get some rest. See you guys first thing in the morning, meet back here, and we'll go up to Professor Sanchez before heading out on our expedition. I'll see you guys. Oh, and don't forget, Jesse Hughes. Pleased to meet you.
Yes, Mr. Hughes. Please, step into office.
And I step outside, outside the bar where I talk to Larkin.
Yeah, Elias raises an eyebrow and will step outside of you.
You'll have been here for
months. And he'll show Mr. Hughes the picture of his sister.
Perhaps you see my sister.
Huh.
Stasha?
You know, I didn't have... I don't have a good description of what the girl who was going with Larkin on the first expedition in Puno. But I reckon that looks a little bit like her. Couldn't be sure.
Are you saying my sister could have gone with this man?
Yeah, I don't trust him at all, buddy. I reckon Mr. Larkin there, he might have something going on.
Do you know where this Larkin prepared for last expedition? Who he talked to?
I think De Mendoza is his go-to guy. He's the local that knows all the contacts. But he's a tough...
It's possible.
Not
to crack. It's possible, Mr. Hughes. Thank you.
All right. He smiles and heads off to his hotel room. Leaving you guys. Yeah.
And Kaskov rejoins the others.
Nice. We do have some wild magic surges. Tennessee, Koskov, and Lucian each have a wild magic surge. You guys let me know what you get, and I will look those up for you in a moment here.
Yep, already got mine. Mine one was 9097.
9097? For 1d100, sorry, for 1d10 rounds, any spells nearby turn their casters yellow. maybe you've got some not so good fish. Lucian, it's making you feel a little ill. Stop eating it after a bit.
I've got a 5584 for Tennessee.
5584 for Tennessee. You disgorge a 2-foot square pane of glass. You don't disgorge it, but I'll tell you this, Mr. Gray. You have an item in your possession, which you traveled with, which is Peruvian in nature, which you're probably looking to get identified or maybe even sell while here in Peru. Let's sort of save that one. Koskov.
5836.
5836 for Mr. Romanovich. You have a small lump on your forehead, like a horseshoe. Like a scar, maybe? Like an old scar, kind of in the shape of a horseshoe. From some old wound. I like that. Okay, thank you, the two, for those. Oh boy, we're just smashing through these viewer decisions with the subs. Thank you guys for all of the subs today. I'll read these out at the end of the show. But we do have a viewer decision now, and what I would like you guys in the chat tell me. Oh yes. Underneath this line, who else is in the bar? Who else is in the bar? Give me some ideas. Now, it is getting later. Is there anything that you guys still wish to discuss or do this evening as you're in Lima? Whilst it is getting late, it's not necessarily the time where everyone just goes to sleep, because when it's late, it's the only time that it's not blisteringly hot. So shops are still open and people are still out and about sort of in the evening nighttime, because it's nice to travel and just to be out in the night. So you don't have to just go right to bed. But you do all have hotel rooms to check into. You've all been given the same hotel. Your rooms are all basically down the same corridor. Which is actually upstairs here in Bar Cordano.
Are they nice rooms? Relatively speaking.
Yeah, relatively. I think I have a really specific amount of info on the hotel rooms that the module actually gives me. about like when they were renovated and stuff, which is great, but I can't find it right now. But basically, they've been sort of renovated within the past 10, 15 years, let's say. So, like, they're kind of like oldish hotel rooms, but like, they're higher than the standards that you might find elsewhere in Peru at this time.
Would it be safe to assume, Will, that they probably have like an open kind of wrought iron balcony and like a Spanish design and things? Okay, look over the. Mm-hmm. Just sitting up later.
It's like it's the style that like tacky hotels nowadays would seek to replicate. I think, but genuine. It's the real McCoy, right? Rather than anything else. So you guys are left alone in Bar Cordano. What do you guys like to do?
Lucian is gonna stand up. Please excuse me. I I am going to go around the few local establishments for medicine and see what I can learn, and then I am going to go to bed as I am feeling somewhat unwell. And he looks at the half-eaten fish and pushes it to one side and... Please excuse me.
Never order the fish.
Never eat fish.
Scampers out.
Yeah, Marcus's plate would have all fruit that you had to peel to eat. And we would just be sitting there.
He's gonna die. Like smart men.
I have to say, it's not a good sign when your doctor's looking sick before the expedition's already began.
Yeah. I give him a week.
Yeah, it's favorable.
I'm an optimist.
You're a talker too, Mr. Romanovich. You had several discussions outside.
Well, I have business here other than business.
It's obviously none of mine, but
well,
I'm curious nonetheless.
How long you been here?
Oh, I come and go, my man.
Then perhaps you could help.
And he will pull out this picture of a, again, young 20s, fair hair.
I am looking for a sister.
Is this somebody that, is this like a luck roll or something that maybe
you
would have run into her?
You wouldn't actually have seen her before. I think it would be... so far out of the realms of likelihood that you would have met her that you wouldn't be able to roll a luck roll. But she, you know, she's clearly out of place in somewhere like Peru. You know, her like pale skin of the, you know, like a Russian beauty. She would stand out probably if you were to see her around here. But you meet so many people that have to say.
He would slide the offered picture over and kind of show it to Catherine.
No, I'm sorry, my man. I haven't seen this girl.
Terribly sorry, I haven't seen her either.
I appreciate it.
Pretty.
Keep eye out.
It hands the picture back.
Who is she, if you mind me asking?
She is my sister. She wanted to come for weather.
To Peru?
I am not a fan.
Neither am I.
I prefer cold. Once you grow accommodated to cold, you are set for life.
Plus you can layer with your wardrobe, so you can, yeah. You have something on top and something, it's fantastic, but...
The... accessorize, you mean, no?
I meant layer, but accessorize, fine, sure.
So, Mr. Romanovich, you're saying you think your sister was here in Lima?
Well, she was in the area. I've not heard for some time. When I got a call from Larkin, thought I would take care of personally.
Oh, did you know Mr. Larkin before today?
I've heard name. In my business, you hear names.
Now, what do you think about this Jesse's claim then that Mr. Larkin might not be on the up and up?
Few men I work with are on up and up. It's not new.
Well, that's fair enough. Would you all care for another drink, or are we all retiring for the night?
I will have another. Besides, I'm paying, so please. Have your fill.
Cosco, about the corner of your eye, you see something that interests you. There's a sweaty and pasty-looking gentleman in a suit which is far too large for him, and his tie, which is quite askew. He sits down at the bar, orders a drink with a slightly nervous voice, looks over, shoots a glance over towards you, and sort of does this.
Excuse me. Every
now and again, he shoots a glance over.
I will take care of Tab.
And Koskov will get up and walk over, standing near the guy, but not right next to him.
You'll have problem with I. Excuse me, me.
He speaks to you. His accent is clearly American. He says, yeah. You're someone who can help with that, right?
Help with what?
My eye problem.
All the pins. What caliber of bullet do you need for eye?
Well, I'm kind of looking to prevent a bullet. Catch my drift. And he looks around nervously at the bar entrance.
And Kaskov will kind of take his time to just take his hat off, look around, try to catch what he's motioning towards nonchalantly. Mm-hmm.
Yeah, he's looking around the room, but you can't see anyone who... He looks like he's just wary for anyone who's coming in. In particular, you've seen people who are on the run before. This man strikes you as someone who's clearly very, very nervous. Catherine and Jordan... and Marcus Jordan. Could you guys roll me luck checks?
Sure. Extreme success.
Okay.
Failure.
This man is Mr. Gerald Ellis, and he is an American diplomat, international, foreign correspondent, not unlike yourself, Marcus. You've recognized him from hundreds of other, gatherings and meetings before, and it is certainly very, very strange that he would be here. And he's speaking of Koskov.
Yeah, Catherine had put her hand on Marcus's leg. Oh, Marcus, dear, you recognize Gerald Ellis over there? Seems awful nervous.
He's a bit American.
You're making me a bit nervous, dear. You sound a bit like a robot.
Now you do a roboting a little bit, you're frozen on our screen. Try a refresh. Tortured by some kind of
it's a great look also.
It's a good pose. This thing's absolutely pissed. Catherine, what are you doing while your husband is maybe a little inebriated?
Just pat him. There, dear. Catherine would, is he back?
He's back.
Okay.
I don't know, am I?
Mostly?
Mostly?
Can you guys hear me? Is it okay? No clue with that.
Yeah, sound better.
Yeah, we can hear you. You're stop motion, but...
Oh, boy.
Okay. I see him. He always looks sweaty, though. He's American.
Yeah, but he looks a bit sweatier than normal, don't you think? He keeps looking over his shoulder. I think someone's after him, finally.
He's American.
Marcus would go over and, if Gerald knows him, it's only polite.
Mm. Gerald, my man.
Well, mate.
He looks... shocked to see you.
Yeah. Marcus, hey. Hey, good to see you. Just having a conversation here, a private conversation with my friend, Mr. Romanovich.
Oh, yes. Marcus is my friend, and if my friend, he is your friend.
It's good to see you, Gerald. Right.
Kathy, hey.
Please, you look distressed. You do not look good. Not хорошо, as we say in Russian.
Yeah, I'm not feeling so good. You know what, let's speak somewhere private. I'm staying here in the hotel, room 204. I'll see you there.
And he casts his eyes around again and heads upstairs into the hotel.
That's unusual.
He always like that?
He says to the Jordans.
Well, typically he's a bit less paranoid, you know, but he's always been a bit sweaty.
Well, given circumstance, can't hold against him.
Circumstance.
The weather.
Oh, he's hot. Well,
most people
sweat.
So is
everyone else. Not that much. Perhaps the doctor should take a look at him.
After he done taking a look at self. Well, I suppose we should go see what he wants.
Yeah, Dom.
Oh yeah, Tennessee will just approach at some point once the conversation starts to slow down and say, you know, I think I'm going to take a walk myself. We'll have to do that drink again and maybe breakfast tomorrow.
It's lovely meeting you, Mr. Gray.
Oh, lovely meeting you too, and your husband. I hope to find out a lot more about you in the days to come. Mr. Romanovich, I can't expect that I might see you again after this, and I didn't expect to see you down here, but I am glad you are with us.
You too.
Tennessee will walk out.
After he walks out, he'll turn to the droids.
He's good egg. Means well. Little naive.
Seems fairly knowledgeable about certain things.
What is Lucien doing at this point, by the way? As he's probably the only one left at their table.
Oh, Lucien got up and left.
He's already done his okay.
Yeah, he went out of the hotel, and after he went to the nearest toilet and purged his stomach, he's probably going around to the local hospital, and he wants to learn about local diseases, maybe like local remedies, things you should use, things you shouldn't use, basically just gain knowledge.
Okay, very cool. So that leaves the Jordans and Koskov together. Are you guys heading up to the hotel room?
Koskov was going to, after he squared away the tab with the barkeep, which he would also just ask right quickly as he's sliding over a much larger sum of money than the tab would warrant, but also holding a picture of his sister and be like, have you seen? And keeping his hand on the money.
Okay. Cameron and Marcus, you guys are heading up with Koskov?
I think so. Checking on.
Be going up to Gerald. Room, yeah.
Okay. You guys see room 204 as the bar and restaurant sort of fades away from behind you. The door is currently closed.
Go up and Koskov's got a rap on the door with his pinky ring, just like really kind of sharp and loud.
There is no answer after a considerable amount of time.
He just kind of tiredly looks at the Jordans.
Is he always like this?
He's an American.
So nah. Well, we should do as they do in America, no?
And then Koskov kicks the door open.
I was going to say, eat unhealthily and sleep late, but...
You kick open the door. There isn't much to this door whatsoever. It's probably just made out of, like, cork. So you're lucky that you don't actually throw your whole body through it as it comes off the hinge. And you step into a empty hotel room. There's a bed, there's a side table, there's that, little kind of veranda, as mentioned. And no sign that anyone has been in here. Indeed, it would seem as though the room has been cleaned as well, as though it's had a room service.
How recently does it appear to have been cleaned? Like, can we still smell like the cleaning products
probably.
In the air?
Yeah, probably okay. Today.
He's quiet.
We're almost spot hidden if you wish to look around.
Yeah, Koskov is looking around, sure.
Yeah, Catherine would too.
I fail.
Art success.
Regular success for Marcus.
Catherine on a hard success. Marcus, first of all, would see like where it has been fairly very well cleaned. There are a few points that around the bed. There have been like scuff marks, and whoever scuffed this did so quite a bit, more than just like walking around on a carpet. You know, you would have to like, you know, if you really like digging your foot into a carpet, that kind of thing, with some pressure, that's the kind of scuff mark that you have. And Catherine, you have found on a one of the sideboards, the skirting boards. Mm-hmm. There is two tiny flecks of blood.
Just gonna kneel down. Oh, there appears to be a little bit of blood here.
Oh,
some scuffs. Maybe a tussle. Is the blood still like fresh, or is it dried and old? Oh, it's fresh blood. That's a bit unnerving.
I suppose.
She'll kind of like hold her purse a little closer to her.
Yeah, and as y'all look back at Koskov, he already has like a revolver in his hand as he's like now looking around the room with them.
As you look back, Koskov, and let the shut door, you can see now that on the door itself, on like the inside of the door, which you didn't see upon entering, there has been written a message, and the message reads, "One, two, buckle my shoe."
JJ, what am I doing here?
It looks to have been written in some kind of paint, like black paint.
You know, here comes one, two, buckle, shoe. Oh. That was 3-4.
And he turns back to the others.
Shut the door.
Is the door shut?
Yep. There's no other message.
Kossoff's going to open the door and kind of look at down the hallway, both sides.
It's like some cleaning stuff.
Well, we are told to go to room. It is empty. There is blood and a message. This is now interesting.
Whew. Certainly something. Marcus. Oh, you're frozen. He's in shock.
Yes, you're handling this better than your husband.
Oh, well, he'd had a bit too much to drink, I think. He was a bit stuttery there for a little bit, but it happens.
You're going to be traveling with me. You need to hold liquor. We will be drinking a lot.
Well, I'm Irish. I've had a few drinks here and there. Bit of drinking experience.
Ah, I'm sure.
You guys leave the room?
If another quick look around, shows nothing, then...
Right. Mm-hmm. Pretty much. Yeah. That is pretty... the only message.
Yeah. Well, Koskov's seen all he needs to see here.
Okay. You head out of the hotel room 204, which is on the floor just above your own. Head back down to the bar. Everything's nice and friendly again. And still no sign of Mr. Ellis, who has gone mysteriously missing in his hotel room.
Mm.
It's pretty late by this point, probably close to sort of midnight.
Okay.
If you guys wanted to retire or do anything else, just a minute.
Yeah, Koskov would be ready to retire. By the way, I don't know if you caught it, Will. Earlier when I was paying my tab, I was asking if the bartender had seen my sister, and I was sliding him the money to pay off loyalty. Bartender...
Yep, he is. Yeah, he's taking the money. This is probably more money than this guy has seen in a long time. But he's taking it.
Did he say whether or not he had seen her?
He hasn't.
Hmm.
But he's going to keep an eye out.
Demo.
I think Marcus and I are going to be retiring for the evening. It was a pleasure meeting you, Mr. Romanovich.
And you, Mr. Jordan.
She'll take Marcus by the arm and lead him up to the room.
Dobivriche.
And Koskov will have another shot before going upstairs.
Now let's cut over to Mr. Tennessee Gray, who has gone exploring and a little walk around Lima. Is there anything you'd like to be doing in particular, Tennessee?
I think without a guide, he considers, and he spent most of the day walking around, he considers another walk around, visiting merchants or maybe, you know, trying to find someone who might be selling some occult wares, but then he thinks twice about it, and instead he'll return to the hotel and go looking for Jackson Elias's room.
Okay, yeah, asking around and probably paying someone off will lead you to Mr. Elias's room, which is a room. Oh wait, I should make this poignant about the the famous room. It's room 306. You're gonna go to his hotel room.
Yeah, what floor are we staying on?
Are you guys staying on the first floor? Mr. Gerald Ellis was on the second floor, and Jackson Elias is on the third floor.
All right, yeah, I'll go ahead and go to room 306 then, and Tennessee will knock with his cane on the door. Mr. Elias, Jesse, are you in there?
Yeah, he opens up the door.
Hey, Mr. Gray, how can I help? Come in.
Little nightcap?
Absolutely, I would love a nightcap. What do you have in here? And he'll step in.
Yeah, he says, some gin tonic, right? And he goes into a little bar that he has.
I'll take the gin.
Yeah, slides over a glass towards you. So, how can I help you, Mr. Gray?
Well, a couple of things. First off, I wanted to say that I appreciated your forthrightness in coming out and telling us who you were and what your concerns about the expedition are. Obviously, whenever you go into bed with a group of people, you want to know everything that you can about them.
You're welcome. I like to know who I'm traveling with as well.
Now, I know that you and I might not see eye to eye on this Percy Fawcett issue, and that's fine. I absolutely respect your opinion. But I did have something I wanted you to take a look at, and no one's been able to help me so far, but you said you're something of a folklorist, is that right?
Sure. Yeah, certainly, yeah.
He'll pull out of his pocket this small glass Peruvian artifact and put it down on the table, pick up his glass of gin, and continue drinking. Now tell me, you ever seen anything like that before?
Huh. He seems intrigued immediately and will take a look at it, looking it up and down.
Yeah, no, this is interesting. You know, the only time I've ever seen anything like this was when I was in England. And, what are they called? The Penhew Foundation. Yeah, this, they're related to the Carlisle Expedition. Are you familiar with it? I went off.
Well, I've heard of the Carlisle Expedition, yes.
Yeah, yeah, they're still out there.
If you ask me.
Yeah. But Penhew, their foundation, they're the real stuff. They got stuff from all over. And most of their stuff's from Egypt. You know what? I would have to get in touch with them, but I would suggest this thing isn't at all from Peru. It's not like anything I've seen.
Very interesting. So you're saying you think it might be Egyptian in nature?
That would be my guess.
Well, thank you. That's the most anyone's been able to tell me about it so far. And he picks up the object and slides it back into his pocket.
Yeah, yeah. Let me, in fact, he's going to go and write down the telephone number of the Penhew Foundation in England in case you want to call them at some point. You find a telephone, you get in touch, tell them I sent you. Good folk.
Absolutely. Yes, I would be interested in finding out more about it, for sure, but that is not why we're here in Peru, I suppose. Let me ask you this. I know that you've been forthright in telling us a lot of information and your suspicions about our benefactor, but is there anything you're not holding back? Because I want us to have an honest relationship. You're going to get honesty from me, and I feel like you might be holding on to some more information still.
All right. Fair enough. I guess I pitched you guys the normal stuff, so I didn't seem like I was fucking crazy. But there's a thing or two I've dug up about the Mendoza.
That's the locals. The big fella with Larkin.
Yeah, yeah, got the tattoos and yeah. The locals they say he might be one of the Karasiri. Now, Karasiri is a local, is a word which roughly translates to some kind of vampire. The story goes, back when the conquistadors came, that there was the folk from this land protected it, and they had the gods on their side. The gods were not friends to the newcomers, the outlanders who were coming in and taking over their territory, so they had their special servants, the Karasiri. These creatures were more than just human. They were vampires, but not vampires like we would call them. They don't suck out the blood. They suck out the fat. They leave you a husk. Demodose has got a pretty bad reputation. He's a scary guy, been involved in all sorts of uprisings and murders. Even worse. The locals are naturally scared of him, and they call him a Karasiri. It's like calling someone a monster. They wouldn't ever say that to his face, of course, and I don't recommend you do the same either. But Demondoza, he's bad news. And I don't trust him at all.
Well, I should be sure to keep that in mind, and Tennessee doesn't seem particularly phased, except for when he moves to set his glass of gin back down on the desk. His hand is shaking a little bit, and the glass rattles against the top of the surface. Well, that's good to know there, and obviously if he's working closely with Larkin, then, well, it is messy venture we find ourselves in, but we are in the Wild West of exploration out here. I'm glad that someone who knows the scene is here, someone like yourself.
Well, I'm honest with you, Mr. Gray, I've never seen anything which can't be explained by science. Now, this cult that I mentioned to you, if Larkin and Demandolza are involved, then they're just nut jobs, believing in something which is, long gone and probably never existed in the first place. Now, of course, I might be totally wrong. They may be just there looking to make a quick buck on some Peruvian artifacts. Whatever it is, we'll be okay out there, as long as we watch each other's backs. We'll carry him.
Well, I'm with you. There is only science, but I understand the power that superstition holds over the people.
Certainly.
I'll definitely look out for your back, and I hope you'll do the same out there. Don't want to keep you. We have a long day tomorrow, but thank you for your time and the phone number. I appreciate that. I'll be in contact with the Penhue Foundation.
All right. Thanks, Mr. Gray, and have a good night's sleep.
Have a good night, Jesse. Neil, exit. Go back to his room.
Okay. So, Lucien, going around the local medical practice, you've probably already made sure to give yourself enough shots on the way here that you're not going to, you know, catch anything too bad. Mm-hmm. But, you know, you can go around and get supplies and medicine, probably buying them for your journey for at least, you know, a few weeks. Usual jab shots, pills, that kind of thing. Even just for like altitude sickness, that sort of thing.
That's essentially what Lucien was doing. Just getting supplies, asking locals, you know, about diseases, what plants to use, you know, just basically information gathering and resource gathering for in preparation for the journey.
Okay. So
once he's done that, you'd head to bed.
Head to bed, yeah. Alrighty. So, the group of you then get some rest, and we pick up on the next morning. Are we all meeting Jackson Elias, aka Jesse Hughes, at Bar Cordano, like crack of dawn?
Is there any chance that we could have a brief scene in the room with the Jordans?
Okay. Absolutely. I've got a AFK for 2 seconds, so go ahead and do that.
There we go. So it would be out on the balcony as Marcus would be smoking a cigarette. And as soon as the door closed and he looks around and looks down, he would turn back to Catherine and go,
"Was it all right? Did everything go all right?"
"Dear, you were fine. I keep telling you, you're absolutely fine. You took a good handle on the situation like I told you to. It's all good."
"Good. All right. I'm getting better, I think, eh?"
"Practice does help. We've been at this for about four or five years now."
Remember when we started, it was touch and go there a bit, but I...
I thought you were going to shake right out of your boots.
made of sterner stuff now. I have a wife to take care of, so fantastic. Good. Think of all of this.
The bit of blood I found was a bit disconcerting. You think another assassin's after him? I mean, if it was me, I wouldn't have been near that sloppy, so obviously they want something to be found. Or maybe he was trying to leave a trace of him.
But was it just children's? I mean, I want to buckle on my shoe. I mean,
that's a stupid clue.
Right, but I mean, it's odd. Everything's strange. It's not. Have you seen this? I haven't. Never seen it before. It's very odd.
It's quite strange. Not sure what to feel about it. Ugh, whatever. I'm just going to tune my violin.
He's sitting out on the balcony, and as I can still hear a little band number being played, so too can Marcus.
Do you hear that?
Oh, I hear it.
It's almost loud enough to dance to, right?
I think it's just loud enough.
He would offer her his hand.
She would take it.
And on the balcony of the Jordans, they dance a bit.
All right then. So the next morning, the group of you arrive back at Bar Cordano, downstairs. Get some breakfast and a few drinks, and meet Jackson Elias, Jesse Hughes, who is back in role as Jesse, and is like, excellent, excellent. Nice to see you all again. Let us head down to the university to meet with Professor Sanchez before we get off on this expedition, shall we? Excellent. And he is up and at him bright and early. He is clearly a morning person. One of those really annoying people who are just super energetic first thing in the morning. He sets off striding through the streets of Lima over towards the university. So, you arrive at the building, which is both a museum and a university. So the campus itself has a museum on it. And that's where Professor Sanchez is at his offices. He is going to stop just before the door to the office and says, "So, just remember, one thing about Sanchez is he doesn't like the idea of foreigners coming in and stealing Peruvian artifacts. So, while we're going on this expedition, it's a good idea to ally ourselves with Sanchez's ideas that we're just here to investigate, right?"
All right. You got it.
All right.
Missionaries.
He on the door, and a few moments later, Professor Sanchez opens the door. He's wearing a long coat and has a beard and glasses on. And he greets Jesse Hughes with a smile. Not like a really full smile, but he's clearly there to see him. He says, "Oh, Mr. Hughes, pleased to meet you and your friends." And Jesse's, "Oh, yes. Marcus and Catherine Jordan, Koskov, Lucian, Dr. Lucian, and Mr. Tennessee Gray." And Sanchez smiles, shakes hands, "Please come in." And walking into Professor Sanchez's office on the ground floor, it's an airy, tall-ceilinged room with white walls and shelves filled with books and artifacts. Dominating the room is a large hardwood desk piled high with papers, books, and journals. He keeps the windows open, so the air is flowing through, so it's a little bit less hot than the sweltering heat of Lima. He says, "So, friends, how can I help? This is about Larkin." And Jesse nods, says, yes, that's right. My friends here are going on an expedition, isn't that right? With Mr. Larkin."
Yeah,
that's right.
Yes.
That's
absolutely.
Yeah, he doesn't like the sound of that whatsoever. You can tell just by his face. "Well, okay. I have tried to speak with Mr. Larkin many times, and he has not spoken to me. I know most of the history of this pyramid. I have even found a document dating from the mid-16th century, written by a conquistador by the name of Gaspar Figueroa, which may refer to the site in question.
Document is difficult to read, so my assistant, Rizzo, she has been working on a summary for the details. She is downstairs. Should be coming soon. And he points down to a room which leads into like a basement area, and there's a door down the end of that, which is has Rizzo's name on it, his assistant. He looks towards Lucien.
I was just wondering if she is almost finished. It would be great to know what is said.
Oh, yes. Soon.
What fortuitous timing. For my own knowledge and interest, what was the place that we're going to originally used for? Do you know the history of it? What it was used for?
I don't know too much about the site itself, if it is even in existence, or if it is a story tale.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
But if this site did exist, then the pyramid would have been a religious site.
Interesting.
So
interesting.
Practice of a gift giving to the gods, that kind of thing.
Yes, absolutely. So I'm going to assume that Larkin has more than just stories about this place. There must be some sort of evidence that he has that to start this expedition, surely.
He hasn't agreed to meet and read this document of Gaspar Figueroa's. So maybe he has other artifacts he has not shown me, so I cannot tell you. But maybe he has something. If you have met him, perhaps he has shown you.
No.
So why, as someone who is knowledgeable in this area, we were told that he was tried to get on the expedition, but was refused, weren't we?
Yes, he has tried to reach out to Larkin many times.
So, did Mr. Larkin, did he give any indication as to why you were not allowed to join this expedition?
He has just not replied to my messages and requests to meet him. Maybe it is because he is there to loot the site. Now, there is no law preventing foreigners from coming in and stealing Peruvian artifacts. So he knows that I do not like that, and I would see them return to my museum here, where they belong, but he is probably going to try and steal them. That is my thinking on this. He does not care for the history, and he wants the money.
I see, yes. And that would make sense not to bring you along, as you would actively attempt to stop that. Yes,
oh,
I
see.
Yes.
Now look here, Professor. You said you have a museum here where the artifacts from the temple should be. Do you have any other artifacts from this particular site already here in your museum?
I do not. Not from this one, this site. The only thing I have is from this Gaspar Figueroa diary. I have not found anything from the site, but I have not gone looking myself. It is unexplored, so its very existence is unknown to me. But Rizzo should be here any minute now.
Yes, I would be very interested in seeing what she has to say about this document you've mentioned. In the meantime, I want you to know that we are going on this expedition, and we have no interest in letting that place be looted and sold. We are there purely for educational and scientific reasons. So if Larkin is up to no good, don't worry. You have an ally in us.
He smiles. Oh, that is good to hear. I've seen many Americans and others come through here asking me for advice, only to go on and steal things.
Tragic.
Oh, see. Very, very sad. Many pieces have been lost to archaeology and our cause here at the museum. I hope that this Larkin fellow, he does not do the same. If you can implore him to bring them back to the museum, I would happily buy them from him, as I have told him many times. I may not be able to pay as much as the Americans back home, though. Peru is not rich.
They do have money. Yeah. Do you know about his last expedition? I've heard he went recently. Small group.
I heard about this. There was a man and a girl. They came here, and they asked me advice on going, and said they were going with Larkin. And I said that the same I told you. But I have not seen them, and Larkin came back only after about a week. So he was not there for long.
Now, Professor, please look careful.
And he pulls a picture out.
Was this girl?
Oh, see, that was her. Beautiful, had accent like you. And she was with a man, I think American. He wore a suit. They asked me about the same questions you have been asking me as well. I was still translating the Gaspar Figueroa document, so I did not have that ready for them in time. But this was maybe a month ago. Maybe less.
Nah.
They seem nice.
Yeah.
Are they friends?
Do not concern yourself.
And Kaskov kind of stands back and is actively brooding right now.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
Tennessee notices the brood, and he kind of steps forward and he says, well, you've been very helpful so far, Professor, and thank you very much. You've given us a lot of good information and things that we will certainly put to use in the field.
You're welcome. It is my job here to help. He looks over his shoulder again. Don't know what is taking Rizzo so long.
Perhaps a knock on the door would...
We could go check on her, yeah.
I mean, she must be absorbed into what she's doing.
See? Okay. He heads down there with the group and knocks on the door. Rizzo! Lost in the work sometimes, you know?
Absolutely.
And
Catherine's gonna kind of shoot a glance over at Mr. Romanovich. I can talk.
Which he meets the glance and narrows his eyes.
He opens up the door. And looks around a storeroom which has no lights on, and he goes to find like a switch to get some light on in here, and stumbles around as you guys look inside. He finds it, and you hear then a cry of surprise and anguish from Professor Sanchez. As the lights flicker on, you'll see that there is a woman in the center of the room who is clutching a ripped document in her hand. However, her body is no longer clearly alive. But secondly, she looks like she has been drained and that her skin is sitting close to her flesh. As though she were almost skeletal.
and she is lying down there. And I would like everybody to roll me the first sanity check of the game.
Koskov steps up like this is something he sees every day almost, and gets a closer look.
Terrible way to go.
And he's gonna like look at her, like whatever her dress, shirt, whatever, and kind of pull it away from her collar and see the like the size difference for clothes.
Okay. Greg, you can roll me a sanity check, by the way. I don't know how much you missed, but you've just walked into the storeroom, and Rizzo, Professor Sanchez's assistant, is dead on the floor, and it looks like her body has been drained. Everyone else succeed?
No,
Tennessee succeeds.
It's going to be a long campaign.
I do not require sanity checks to see dead bodies.
Yeah, for this. Yeah. You got a criminal package.
Same!
So,
with a 17, he succeeds.
Nice.
But so I'm pretending, any... like, I'm like, oh, good heavens, this is terrible.
After Lucian, you lose 2 points of sanity for witnessing this. As Koskov, you go over and look at the body and pull away the collar, she has lost over 50% of her, like, body mass. However, she still has blood. And is bleeding from the neck. It is as though all of the fat from her body has been drained out.
And then he sees this and then
losing his mind at this point.
And he turns around and he's like, go to the door, close and look. What does it say?
Yeah, Catherine will immediately close the door and look.
Sanchez is sort of just crying. He's over the body and he's just crying for the loss of his assistant. The door reads 3-4, shuts the door.
So we have to connect soon.
This is just terrible, absolutely terrible. And she's gonna be like, just like holding on to Marcus.
And Jez is like, why? Who would do this?
Is Jackson Elias with us as well? Jesse?
Yeah. Jesse is with you. He looks shocked as well.
Tennessee.
He loses his accent and is like, you know, his form in this movie is fucking hell.
Tennessee will limp over to Koskov's side, and he doesn't look phased either, particularly so, but he does look very interested. You said it looks like she lost her body mass? She
looks small.
Mm-hmm.
Like she's been, like the fat from her body has been drained. The muscles are still there, the blood is still there.
Now look here, Jesse. This looks like something you and I were talking about last night, if you know what I'm saying.
I mean, no, there's no way. This gotta be Duck. He looks towards Lucian. This is your field. There's gotta be something you know about, right?
What are you doing? Lucian kind of snaps himself out. Yes, of course. And he grabs his bag that he always has with him, and he heads on over to the body and starts examining it. Cause of death and all that jazz.
You can roll me a medicine check.
I pass with a 55.
Nice. She was clearly killed by the a blow to the neck, where it looks like a series of circular, it's a circular wound running around, almost like that of a jaw, nice. But far bigger than a human bite. So it's clearly some kind of animal. And it was serrated knives, daggers, or possibly razor-sharp teeth, which would have caused a death like this. As for the draining of her body, you have heard of exsanguination, but this is not that. Her blood is still in her body. It is merely where you can ascertain the fat from her body, which has
could
been...
Could I think of being mistreated, as in she was starved? Like, this is a process over a long time?
This is very similar to victims of, starvation.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
Where, like, you have just no excess, you know, her rib cage is, like, just almost bare. You can see, you know, the bones of her ribs along her stomach. However, to this degree is farther than you've ever seen it. And you've probably been to some war-torn countries mm-hmm. where famine is very common. But she's not looking dissimilar to a victim of, like, a famine. Except from the wound from her neck, which, you know, you can't tell right now if that is related to the loss of fat or if she's
Lucian's
just been down
mind,
here for a very long time.
Yeah, in his logical mind, he's thinking she's been down here starved and that's just how she died, but she was... So, yeah. So he examines... he's going to look all over the body to see if there's any other wounds or indications or even notices signs of abuse or anything like that.
You don't see any, like, long-term bruising along her, anywhere on her body. And there are no signs that she has been, mistreated physically or, like, beaten or anything like that.
Okay.
Aside from this struggle, she does have, like, bruises along her, what's left of, like, the flesh on her arms. But those aren't really there anymore because, you know, the fat having been drained, there's not much to make an impression on her skin.
Lucien's gonna gently pull the fingers and get the piece of note that is still in her. Because she still had a piece of scrap paper in her fingers, right?
She certainly does.
Yeah, so he's gonna take that out and have a look and see what it says. If anything.
Yeah. So I would give you this handout, but having a little trouble with the fancy grounds at the moment. But it is clearly from Figueroa, Gaspar Figueroa, scroll down to find it, and you can get the following text, which has been translated and clearly written most likely by Rizzo. So it reads, Spanish, written by Gaspar Figueroa, 1543 on vellum. Figueroa, Spaniard who had traveled to Peru with Francisco Pizarro. According to the text, Figueroa set out to seek his own fortune following Pizarro's assassination in 1541. He was accompanied by Hernando Rui, Diego Garrido, and Luis de Mendoza. And that's where it cuts off.
Luis de Mendoza? Isn't that the name of one of Lurkin's companions?
It certainly is. The big one with the tattoos.
Yes.
Hmm. Well, and what year did this say this was?
1543.
I have to say, he looks awfully good for someone who is a couple of hundred years old. I have to say that. Or alternatively, it could be someone who just shares the same name. Is
perhaps same family.
Exactly. And he hands it. He holds up the note to see if anyone wants to take it from him.
Tennessee will take it.
Is the body clothed, or is it? Is she completely naked, or does she have her clothes on?
She is wearing clothes. Yeah.
Marcus would start to check her pockets and things of that nature.
And looking around the room, does it look like there are signs of a struggle?
Mm-hmm.
Yes, you can tell that several. Yeah, the papers have been knocked over on the desk. There are boxes which are lying scattered. Someone clearly came in here, and there was clearly a fight. This is very dissimilar to the room in the hotel 204, where there was almost nothing left. This is someone's left this here for you. They clearly mm-hmm. knew that you were going to find this. The message on the door, at least in your
is
mind.
Is there another entrance or exit to this room other than the one that we just came through?
There is. There is a like a cellar door entrance, like a storm door, which isn't far from here, which presumably if someone was here while you guys were, they could have escaped through that quite handily. You do, however, find another extract, Marcus, from the same translation that Rizzo had in her pocket, and possibly wasn't found by her killer in order to remove it. It reads, "Hearing rumors of an ancient temple filled with gold, the men set off in the mountains southwest of Lake Titicaca. They found a pyramid surrounded by a maze-like structure of underground tunnels. The walls of the tunnels were inlaid with intricate gold carvings. The men pried out a large section of the gold, exhausting themselves in the attempt. That night, as they rested, an evil sickness befell Figueroa's companions. In the morning light, they looked gaunt and death-like. Complaining of agonizing hunger, they pursued Figueroa. De Mendoza caught up with him and started to devour him like a human leech. Figueroa shot his friend in the head and fled, pausing only to snap up as much of the gold as he could carry. Figueroa eventually arrived back in Lima, hoping to get passage home, but he was too weakened by his ordeal. Figueroa describes himself as wasted, little more than a walking corpse. I read final confessions as Figueroa's attempt to lift the guilt that his avarice had placed upon him. He believed that his fate and that of his companions was brought by the desecration of a holy place, and his most fervent wish was that he could undo the damage he had inflicted. He describes how he can still hear his friends' voices crying out with inhuman hunger, and how in the dark of night he can still hear another voice, ancient and seductive, promising him eternal life if he returns to the temple. The voice told Figueroa how to contact it, but it seems Figueroa was too afraid to ever attempt this. A postscript written by the priest who performed the last rites states that Figueroa died a day after completing his final confessions. His last words were an entreaty to whatever gods were listening to forgive him of his blasphemies."
And now Larkin looks sick, emaciated.
Is the professor still like over the body crying? He's still weeping?
Yeah, he's sort of gotten over the weeping stage, and he's just kind of looking around in shock at her body. Catches your eyes.
Oh, poor girl, poor girl. Here, Professor, please. You must call the police. We'll keep an eye here and make sure nobody gets in or out.
Yeah,
he kind of helps him up and tries to get him to the door.
Yeah, he heads up and is going to, call for the police.
Is he out of earshot now?
Yeah, he's out of earshot.
Lucy's gonna take a look. Goes, this girl seems to have been very malnourished. The only places I've seen of this case is starvation. It would seem that the professor clearly starved this poor girl.
Maybe, Doctor, that's not quite the case. And Tennessee closes the door slowly, turns around with a glance to Jackson Elias, says, Jackson, would you like to tell them what you told me last night about the local reputation of certain Mr. Mendoza?
Yeah. Okay, so here's the deal. The locals, they call the Mendoza a Karasiri. Basically, it's a monster or a vampire. It's because the guy's got a reputation of killing. He's not a good guy. You know, he's been involved in all sorts of civil wars, uprisings across the world, you know. And now he's back here, he's... So the locals, they whisper, and that's what they call him. But the ancient story goes that... Karasiri were a group of elite warriors who protected the ancient temples against the conquistadors, and that they would suck out the fat of their victims. Intriguing. And that they would stay alive because of that.
I'm assuming they would do it through their jaw of some kind, yes?
It's not clear.
this, and he shows him visibly the wound that is, because to me that very clearly looks like a jaw of a animal that I could not say. Normally an animal such as this would not be so clean. It would rip into the flesh. It'd be, there would be blood everywhere. Mass amounts of traces of blood. This is too precise, too clean.
I don't know what to tell you, Doc.
Which could fit into this fat-sucking creature that you talk about.
That's just a rumor, just a folklore tale. There's no one that's ever been seen no one's ever seen a Karasiri, right? They're from hundreds of years ago. They're just tales. Now, no, I'm not saying, Doc, that there are people out there who don't believe in them. And that's the important thing. Now, would I be able to get on board with the idea that someone is has found a method to replicate these acts of horrible murder in order to send a message? Absolutely. The stuff I saw down at Lake Titicaca, all the death cults down there, they would do crazy stuff like that. So absolutely, there may be some kind of blade or device he's made, some cultist has made in order to extract that kind of thing. But if we're talking here that there are actual vampires from 400 years ago walking around Peru sucking out the fat of people, I think that's a little hard to believe, Doc.
Yes, I would agree. It is more likely that, as you said, someone is mimicking these creatures and using a certain device to do so, although such a device that could suck so much fat out of a person in such a small space of time would be quite astonishing. But that's not
to say. I mean, do we know how long this was taken? You said yourself she might have been down here a very long time. What if it's a process?
I don't suppose I could guess the time of death because body's been...
The blood is fairly fresh. So she probably died today, but the process of like the starvation, that could have been happening for a very long time, and this could have just been like the death wound.
I see. So you believe that the professor is responsible for either A, starving this girl, or B, using this girl as an experiment.
I'm not blaming the doc. He looked pretty shook up when he saw her.
So some random person that the doctor knows nothing about has come in for days, weeks, even, and he did not notice?
Listen, I'm not an investigator.
This is maybe easy to take care of. We asked the doctor when was the last time he saw her. If she was malnourished then we know that there's a problem. If not, then she was fine. I mean, if there's witnesses that have seen her, where she is not husk, then...
Okay, that's a good idea. But okay, what about that fucking message on the door? 3-4, shut the door? That wasn't there, that's painted on.
Well,
I'll tell you something else. That Mendoza guy, if we're thinking about him, he doesn't speak a word of English. He couldn't let alone write that.
No, but Larkin does,
how do you
right?
know this? How do you know?
I guess it's possible he hid it from me.
So is that message worth something? I mean, is there a reason that's here? I mean, why?
It looked like it should be there.
Perhaps they have sticks that need picking. You will find out
that's
soon.
That's my concern as well. That's not the end of the saying. It continues. It's fantastic.
Well, it must be
so they need to.
In that case, it must be a first part of the saying, right? Want to?
Nah. Yes, we saw last night.
Oh, shoes.
Wait, you saw something last night?
Nah. They draw dance, they'll tell.
We didn't really see anything, but
Marcus, you were very shook up. You did not talk for a very long time.
I apologize, I've been in and out the entire time.
Yes, go to talk to a friend of theirs, some American. He looked frustrated. We go to see him, room 204. He was gone. There was blood, there was saying, here we are.
Right. Did you report this to the local authorities? Missing person, blood in the room.
Yes, doctor. We called them right away.
Right. Okay, so they know.
Immediately.
Excellent. So they know that there could be a dangerous criminal out there killing people. Right, no problem. Right, yes.
You said there wasn't a body. It wasn't like this?
Nope, no, there is no sign of Mr. Gerald Ellis.
Okay. Yeah. Okay, that's weird. Was the paint fresh?
It is a bit fresh. There's a couple drops of blood. One scuff on the bedpost.
The paint as well. Yeah, this stuff's fresh too. Someone was here recently.
And Costco's gonna open the door and just kind of yell out to the professor.
Professor, when is the last time you see girl?
He heads down. last night. She up all night in here.
She looked fine.
And I go home. Oh, see. Rizzo, she was well.
Okay.
Lucien's gonna go and open the other. There's another door, right? The sewer door. Right. Yeah, he's gonna open it up.
Cellar
door. Sorry, and he's gonna open and have a look.
Yeah, it leads out onto a main street, basically.
Well, it certainly looks like they entered an exit this way. Do you not keep this locked, or?
The professor says, normally it is.
Normally.
Well, let's check. And Costco's going to look at the door and see if maybe if it's been tampered with, picked, forced.
It looks like it's been forced.
Does it look like a strong door? Like a strong lock also?
Yeah, you would need some considerable strength to bust this thing open. It would have been easier to pick it, you would suggest. The lock isn't very complex, after all. Sanchez says, this must have been 10 p.m. last night. So, 14, 15 hours ago, maybe. Maybe more.
You have more strength than brain.
And you were. And when did you first arrive here in the morning? Do you live here, or do you arrive here every day?
I live off campus. I got here 20 minutes before you.
The poor girl died within the early hours of the morning. Would she regularly
could have been as dead as long as, 14 hours ago, Lucien, as far as you can tell. The blood is fresh, but it's been pulled. The paint, you would then surmise, was done sometime after the death. So anywhere, this paint could have been a couple of hours ago, probably at most. Possibly even sooner than that.
So with that time frame into consideration, Will, the paint that we found at Ellis's place, in addition to the paint that was found here, could it still work out time-wise that the other foreign correspondence room, that paint was first, and this would have been almost exactly or rapidly after it?
Rapidly thereafter. There's probably a time frame of around an hour or so. Maybe a little but absolutely. The 1-2 came first, and then the 3-4 was pretty swiftly thereafter.
My friend is painting quickly.
Kill it quickly.
Well, if the body, she was killed more like 12 hours ago, and the paint was more likely done in the past 2 hours, do you think the killer just stayed around and...
No, it's most likely that someone else came afterwards who is following. Either who is following...
Unless he was reading the notes. Reading takes time.
Elias goes around... That bit was torn from my hand. All this stuff is scattered around like there was a fight. I don't know, maybe. Maybe they stayed. I'm thinking the doc might be right. Someone coming in afterwards.
Someone perhaps controlling?
Shoots an eye over towards the doc. Towards the professor. Maybe. I don't know. That's creepy.
So, are you suggesting that perhaps the professor saw the body and wrote these messages?
I don't know. I think we should leave this to the police and we should just...
I agree. This is well above my pay grade. This is well beyond my expertise. I do believe we have found as much information as we possibly can from this gentleman, and we should get ready for the expedition forthwith.
Yeah, I don't think we should be here when the police get here. We're all strangers in a strange land here, and they're not going to let us go easily. We might miss the expedition if we don't leave immediately.
Yes.
That's very true.
The story has right of it.
Sanchez is in shock, but agrees.
Professor Sanchez, I want you to know that if we learn anything about what happened to your poor girl here, I promise to let you and the authorities know.
She was a good girl. This never hurt anyone in her life. Didn't have any enemies or any problems. So.
I'm terribly sorry Please. For your loss.
If the police ask where we are, please let them know where our rooms are, and he'll give him the address of their hotel. Let them know that they can be in contact with Tennessee Gray. I'll be happy to talk to them when we return to Lima, if they desire to, but we must get going now.
I understand. Yes.
Take care, Doc. Good. Take care, good professor. We shall see you again.
Lucian, you have a wild magic surge to roll for me as well.
Oh, okay.
Let's do that.
While Lucian's doing that, Tennessee will approach Koskoff and look up to him. Mr. Romanovich, what the professor Please. Said back there.
Yes.
Kos. What the professor said back there in his office before we came in here. I have a sense that all of this is connected to Larkin and that we might be involved with a bad, bad man.
Duh. I asked him about sister. He said he'd not see her. Why should I not just kill him now?
Well, first off, there is the police to take into account and all of our lives as well, but beyond that,
again,
when we're
out
there in the jungle, we might be able to find your sister or what happened to her. The further we get away, the further we get him isolated and away from his man, the more we can find out about what exactly is going on here.
Ah. You are a smart man. It's good to have you here. Please, keep me from killing him until I find Stasha.
If you feel the urge, just punch me in the shoulder, do what you gotta do, and, we'll get through this and figure out what exactly is going on here, because I do believe, and it is just a hunch, that Larkin and Larkin's man are behind this girl's death, too.
Nah. I do not like this Mendoza. He has look about him. I recognize.
Nice. Well, the locals don't like him either. And he has a reputation with the locals for being one of these creatures that sucks out fat. Now, I don't believe in such nonsense, but that doesn't mean that he doesn't perpetuate his own reputation.
Yes.
Well, shall we?
Well, I trust you. Yes. Let's return with others.
All right. So, Lucian, what did you get in your wild magic?
I got 6636.
Oh, three sixes. You smell strongly of sour milk until you are next wounded in battle. I think this is probably from your sickness the night before. There's a sour staleness about the book.
Milk's gone bad. I'm sweating like there's no tomorrow. Ugh.
So the group of you head off away from the museum in the university campus and head back to Hotel España. Outside, you see that there are several trucks, two large trucks which have pulled up in convoy next to one another, and that there are several Peruvian folk who are like loading them on. They look like they're like the hired help for the expedition, and they're like loading on food and equipment and the like. You spot Larkin. De Mendoza is watching over the locals as they are fixing up the trucks. Larkin himself is standing just outside the hotel watching this. Kind of waves over towards you with a thin hand as you guys make your way into the hotel.
Ah, friends, good to see you. Hope that you slept well.
Dobre utro, Mr. Larkin. Means good morning.
Morning.
The room's been fantastic. Thank you.
Good.
And then Koskov is going to turn to some of the locals that are loading up boxes that say kitchen utensils. And he's like,
be careful, you cut yourself. Do not drop. Please, please.
And then go inside.
Glad to hear you had a good night's rest. Well, hopefully we're all prepared for our expedition up into the highlands. But, set to it, I suppose.
A resplendent offering.
Thank you, Latu gives a magic item and a wild magic search for Koskov and a monster attacks. Ooh. Ooh. Like
that. Lucian's gonna...
So that's now two magic items today?
Yep.
Wow. Lucian is going to approach Larkin. Excuse me, Mr. Larkin. I could not help notice that... Sorry, Doctor. I could not help notice that you are somewhat unwell. I really hope you would tell me what is wrong with you. Otherwise, I will not be able to assist you on this expedition. I would like to know if there are any ailments that expedition members might have, so I may assist you in such things.
Not at all. I am not sick. It's merely just the heat is does not agree with me so well as I'm sure you know, as a fellow Englishman.
Oh, absolutely. I have struggled myself multiple times. I found that just drinking as much as humanly possible is the best way. Keep hydrated, Doctor. Keep hydrated.
Of course. Now, I must see to the supplies.
When you see him jump into one of the trucks.
Right, well, I'm off to my room to get the rest of my clothes and supplies, anything that they may have missed out. I shall meet you all down here very shortly. And Lucian's gonna walk up to his room and start.
Hey, Doc.
Hmm.
Make sure there isn't anything written on the backside of your door.
Oh, yes. Very, very astute. Yes, thank you. And he'll kind of nervously go upstairs.
So the rest of you fetch your bits and bobs, right?
Mm-hmm. Yep. Can't put my violin case and my purse.
Okay. Check our doors.
Yeah, your doors are empty. It looks like no one's been in here. It's pretty normal. The expedition sets off. Larkin will have explained to you that, first of all, you're traveling to Puno, which is a city 3 days from here. And from there, you'll be making your expedition up into the highlands. So Lima to Puno to the pyramid. Larkin is in one truck, and you guys are traveling in the second truck. De Mendoza is also in the other truck, but Jason Hughes, Jackson Elias will travel with you guys to keep an eye on things. He's a little shaken up by having seen Rizzo murdered earlier today, and trying to still come up with theories and ideas as to how she might have been killed and why. So there is a bit of travel to Puno. So what are you guys doing in this hot truck for 3 days, basically? You're driving like 800 miles or so up to Puno.
Lucien will have this little kind of like notebook with him where he writes down all of like theories and medical practices and stuff. Basically, it's like his go-to book for his thoughts and medicine stuff. And throughout the entire journey, not through the entire, he'll enjoy the scenery, but for a lot of it, he'll be cycling through, you know, like symptoms for certain diseases in the local area. He'll even add what he discovered from the poor girl there, you know, a small sketch, symptoms, what happened, theories of what he believes could have done this. And there are some theories that have kind of like asterisks about them, you know, which are a bit more far-fetched. Maybe leave that out of the paper that I might do after this expedition. But basically, that's all he's going to do for most of it. He'll be quite chatty as well if anyone wants to talk to him. But essentially, he'll just make sure that everyone's okay, any injuries he'll treat, but primarily just in the notebook.
Okay. Marcus would be, he has a similar kind of a, almost like a sketch pad, as the idea of having field photography at this time is not practical with the technology. He often sketches small kind of reminders of the stories that he's writing, and he's doing that now and beginning to write down this tale.
Okay.
Tennessee kind of vacillates between being very chatty and interested in who the other people in the expedition are, the workers, especially if they, particularly if they speak English. He doesn't speak Spanish. But then he'll also kind of get withdrawn for long periods of time where he'll be reading old notes and whatnot, writings from Percy Fawcett. And it's like two different sides of his personality. It would be pretty easy to notice that he goes from being very outgoing to be very, very quiet and kind of brooding. But that's pretty much how he would spend his time.
Okay.
Catherine, she'd a little PDA. She's very affectionate towards Marcus. And then she'd probably be, she's fairly quiet, but she would chat a little bit with the others if they seemed chatty, like, you know, just to be polite, keep conversation going. And she'd probably play her violin a little, give a little music to the trip, because I'm sure there's not good radio signal out here for the truck, so.
Alrighty. And Koskov.
Koskov spends most of his time rather withdrawn, and he looks like he's plotting or something. But he spends his time, like, cleaning his revolver, and then he produces a Luger at one point. You might see him sharpening a knife and then testing some brass knuckles. He just doesn't seem to end with the amount of weapons on his body. But he just spends that time doing that and looking at the photo of his sister and kind of quietly, like, mumbling to himself. If he ever catches Larkin in his vehicle, like, I don't know how they are with regards to one another in the trip, but if he sees him, I mean, he spends a lot of time just like glaring at him.
All right. Everybody can roll me a con save, actually, which is to combat the altitude sickness which you're feeling over the course of 3 days traveling from Lima to Puno.
Hard success.
Nice.
Regular success.
Hard success.
Hard success.
Oh, very nice.
And I got a hard success as well.
Nice. So you managed to combat, you know, headaches, dizziness, shortness of breath, nausea, those kind of symptoms as you guys travel into Puno. And on the third day, by night, in fact, you guys will arrive at the city. You're staying here for a night, and then you're moving on into the highlands of Puno. And this will largely be done on foot, as it's very difficult to get trucks all the way up there. And so you're bringing the locals with you to help carry all of the goods that are there. You'll see that Larkin and Mendoza are heading off to a hotel to stay for the night, and most of the camp is breaking up for the evening. You guys have a night in Puno before heading off on the expedition proper. What do you guys like to do?
On the trip there, could we have asked, could Tennessee have asked some of the locals or some of the people traveling with them about Puno? Just information about the city, how big is it? Is there anything to do there?
Anything interesting? Do you speak Spanish?
I don't.
Marcus will translate for him. Yeah, if you have questions, okay. Marcus will.
Yeah.
Oh, thank you there, Marcus.
I'd be happy to, Mr. American.
Yeah. The locals can tell you a few things about Puno. There are a lot of bars to go to, which they intend to drink at. And there are you don't really have a lot of time there, but they'll tell you that Puno's a fairly large city. They will also tell you that there have been several people who have gone missing in Puno. And that they are afraid of the white man because of this. And this is perhaps a reference to the Karasiri, who are considered to be like European and unlike the locals. You know, so one of them has a friend who has a friend who's gone missing, that kind of thing. They're very superstitious people. It's something that you'll get from them. I'll talk to you a lot about the ghosts and the hauntings in Puno. And they're only here because of the money, that kind of thing.
Mendoza, what is he? Is he South American?
He's claimed to not be able to speak English in any way. You would think he looks Peruvian, perhaps.
Okay.
Definitely from around here. He's certainly not like, white. He's certainly not from, Europe, probably. Though he is a little bit hard to read at the best of times.
Does he engage at all?
He hasn't said anything to you. No, he isn't engaged with any of you guys, and you haven't even heard him speak.
Tennessee, have you been trying to? Are you like, well, with Romanovich staring down Larkin and with Mendoza always being around, are you guys kind of like conspiratorially like looking at this group from different angles as you're trying to like vector an approach? If that's the case, Tennessee at some point, I was going to say Marcus is going to walk up at some point. Yeah.
Okay. Yeah.
Should we talk to him or what do you think?
They went off to their room alone, right? The two of them.
They went off to a hotel. Yeah, it's not far. Mm-hmm. You can still in within eye shot.
I do want to talk, not now. I must drink, lest my bad nature come out.
This might be crazy, but what if this is say it's all true, the vampires and the feeding on the fat. What if they're bringing us here to eat?
I mean, right? They brought two before and then more, right?
What do you mean, this particular city, or do you mean the place that the expedition that we're going?
There's people missing everywhere, Doc. They're gone.
Yes, I would imagine it's fairly common in a somewhat more civilized country. Yes.
I'm not sure that the time to confront the man is right now. But
too many people.
Certainly not now.
They will hear the screaming.
And with that, Kaskov, walks to the bar. And then you see him a minute later walk out with a bottle of clear liquid and kind of head back to the truck. And y'all don't see him again unless you come look for him for the rest of the night.
Look, I think it might be worth seeing if we might be able to listen in on anything they might be talking about. I haven't even heard that Mendoza fella speak yet.
right? That's... I mean, we could try, I could translate, we could... could see if he has something to say. Just to do it here in the open, before we're... miles into the bush. I mean...
I would definitely prefer to know if we can trust the man who's leading the expedition before we go too far out of his civilization. So should we go listen? Well, someone who is more apt at listening. It's not really my thing.
Well, I think we're going to come under a lot of suspicion with the locals here, and we should stick together in whatever we do.
Oh, absolutely. I suggest we go to the hotel that they are going there. We can go under the guise of getting a room for ourselves, which would not raise any suspicion at all, and find out which room they are in. Exactly. And then if we overhear something that they're talking about, if they talk, then so be it. Yes?
I think it sounds like a fine idea. We just have to make sure that if they see us, we have a good excuse as to why we're standing outside of their door.
We are going to our room. And we were just standing out there casually talking. How were we to know it was their room?
Loitering.
Exactly. A victimless cry.
Well, should we have a drink first? Give them some time to settle in and get into whatever their nightly routine may be.
Yes, I think a good drink should do us well after 3 days on the road. I could do with some civilized comforts. Neil, head to the bar.
And this place is like a village, right? I mean, this is just a step up for... Right. And with the civilization comment, he would, of course, share a look with Tennessee or Catherine and slowly shake his head. Right. Okay. Right. Civilization.
You guys go and get some drinks, and you'll see that Larkin and Den Mendoza check into their room, and it seems like they are sharing a room. They head upstairs together. There's like the hotel kind of staffer who has dealt with them and given them their keys.
Do we see them actually go into their room? Like, do we know where their room is?
You'll see them go upstairs. You don't know which room it is, unless you wanted to follow them up there.
Yeah, Lucien leans in. I would imagine that this would be a very good time to go follow them to find out which room they're going in.
Also, Will, on the way up, Marcus would lean over the counter, and knowing that they had just gone up, he would ask the clerk or whoever's there in charge what his friends had ordered for dinner. So he could maybe perhaps order the same.
Yeah, he'll give you the recommendation, which is like a fish hot and spicy.
About the fish.
Never trust the fish.
What did they have? He points to where Mendoza and Larkin are going. What did they order?
Gives you a look.
Is it room service? Fish?
All right.
And rooms?
Can I get you a room or some food, sir?
Oh, yes. Rooms. No fish.
Fruit to be had.
Catherine's going to like tiptoe. And
fish for the doctor.
No, she's gonna
Catherine's gonna get up on our tiptoes, give Marcus a kiss on the cheek. I'll meet you upstairs, dear. Let me know where our room is. I'm gonna go freshen up because they didn't have private bathrooms back then, so there'd be like one at the end of the hall. So she'll use this as a pretense to see where, to stealth up there and kind of try to see where the other two's rooms are.
Roll me a listen check, Catherine.
Okay. Just barely a success. Just barely.
You spot Larkin and DeMendoza going into the room. Larkin first, DeMendoza after him, and they close it behind you. Press your rear up to the door to kind of settle in. And you hear Larkin kind of sigh as he seats himself down in a chair. And he says, "Well, how did it go?"
"No, I don't think they suspect anything."
DeMendoza is silent in this entire exchange, though it seems like Larkin is speaking and hearing his replies.
"No, no. Haven't you say? What did it say?" "Lock the door. I don't want Dunsborough here. Not now. This is too important. Be on the lookout. Now, time for a rest, I think. And that's where we're going to end tonight's session."
As you hear both Larkin and DeMendoza falling silent in their room and seemingly unaware.
Tiptoe the fuck away!
Well, 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 my friends. That is our first episode as we have entered into deepest, darkest Peru and begun an expedition and indeed a mystery that perhaps is doomed. But, man, that was fun. That was a good one session. Prepare to run off, but the rest of us here to do our little outros. If you enjoyed tonight's show, please do let us know. If you haven't followed the show yet, hit the follow button and join us. I remind you guys, of course, Warhammer and Star Trek are cancelled this week due to folks being away or ill. So we're going to go off for tonight. This is our one and only show, but man, was it a fun one. Of course, thank you to all the subs as well. You guys are fucking awesome. Jim Song in particular for gifting all of those subs. Thank you, my friend. Definitely check out Call of Cthulhu Masks of Nyarlathotep yourself. We are playing this pretty much by the book with a little twist here or there just to keep things spicy. But you can get it over on chaosium.com. It is an awesome adventure which spans over 669 pages of madness. So, yeah, we're only just starting to get into it, my friends. But let's go around to cast and crew. Did we enjoy ourselves? And of course, where can we find you guys online? Let's start with Greg. How was that, my friend?
It was good. I took care of my internet problems. I love the characters. They're fantastic. Digging the story. It's very... This is Christ, Don said it before. This is a very pulpy version of the regular Cthulhu mythos with the globe trotting and everything. And you really feel it in this type of descent into where we're going to investigate. We're not just going to the library or riding a train or something like that. It really gets into it. And I like it quite a bit. I can't wait to do more. I can't wait to make... Hey, that was our first archaeology role, everybody, that I remember. I think that was the first archaeology role. And I thought that was dope. And we had everything that we needed. And that was super, super cool. Love it. Love it. Can't love it anymore. Grimjack21502 on the Twitches and the Twitters. Just check me out over there, but catch me here next week. Later.
Fantastic. Oh, before I forget as well, we're going to give away a set of tabletop loot dice. Bam! Exclamation point loot in the chat, and you'll be in for a chance to win. Fantastic job, Greg. That was awesome. Loving the accent and the hair. Reminds me of me. Lindy.
Oh, my gosh. So much fun. I've been waiting. I've been waiting for today for so long, it feels like. And I was so happy. I love everyone's characters so much. I can't wait to get to know everybody more. It's all so mysterious. And then this creepy children's rhymes, especially after your character last night, Will. I'm like, whoa. Freaking me out. So this is it's really exciting. I can't wait to see where it goes, the story. Oh, it's so amazing. I can't believe we're finally here. I'm super hyped for next week. I'm going to be counting down the days, counting down the hours. You can find me counting down those days and hours on Laugh Love Lindy on pretty much all the social media, Twitch, Twitter, and the like. I play a ton of tabletop gaming, Call of Cthulhu, D&D, other things. I think in about an hour, I'm going to be on Unmade Gaming's channel with Greg playing something something something. I don't remember what it is, but it's gonna be cool, steampunky. It's gonna be a lot of fun. So check it out.
Fantastic, awesome stuff. And Tom, how was that, my friend?
Oh, it was great. As always, absolutely fantastic. It's great to actually see the characters in live action. You know, you read about them, you hear about them, but you really get a feel for them once they're actually being role-played. And there are already some kind of, like, glances of relationships being discovered. But the great thing about Call of Cthulhu is that relationships can rise and fall at a moment's notice. Just one action can change everything, and that's why I love Call of Cthulhu. The story I'm really interested in, as Greg said, the whole traveling and the fact we use archaeology was a great thing as well, you know, using the more unknown kind of like skill sets in Call of Cthulhu. And I can't wait for next week. I'm like Lindy, I'm going to be counting down those days. You can check me out on I'm Redundant UK. You can check me out on Twitch, Twitter, Redundant UK. I normally hang out in Encounter Roleplay as well, so you can always hit me up on there or on the Discord where I chill out there as well. I'll see you all next week.
Fantastic. And last but not least, Don, how's up?
I loved it. It was really fast paced, exciting, a lot of information already. Like, my notes are already crazy. Like Greg said, super pulpy, but also like it feels very classic Call of Cthulhu and something, even though like our characters are from all over the place and like always, you know, they all have their own perspectives and their own hooks. There's something that feels very, very classy and classic about this team. I'm excited to get to know everybody's characters. I'm excited to find out more about what's on with Peru. And also fat vampires, that's really gross. I don't think it's gonna get less gross, and that's exciting too. So, and you can follow me on Twitter at Donathan Fry. I play other games like these people. Throughout the week I'll post about what I'm up to. This Saturday at 2 p.m. is the season finale of Pulp Cthulhu's Project Cronus on Greg's channel. I'm really excited about that. That's the end of our first season, so it's bound to be pulpy and fun and cool. And I can't wait, most of all, for next week, this game, getting to know these characters a little bit better.
Absolutely. Well, my friends, we're going to be here every week at 1 p.m. Eastern playing more Call of Cthulhu Master of Night Laugh Tip. There's no Warhammer or Star Trek today, so I'll be next week. Today has been so much fun. Thank you again to Chaosium for letting us do this. Check out the masks at chaosium.com and check out the PDF and the print version shortly to be arriving as well. We're going to go... Oh, let me pick this winner real quick here. The winner is La Diet. Congratulations, my friend. You want to set a tabletop loot dice? You're a winner today, my friend. But we'll be back next week for more. Tomorrow is Thursday, which means at 5 p.m. Eastern, we've got The Order, followed by City of Mist, the King's Hustle at 8. We'll see you guys then, but until next time... Oh, we'll go and host a raid. Our good friend, Adam, Call of Cthulhu. He's an awesome streamer and may very well be joining us for some Call of Cthulhu in the near future. Enjoy his stream. He's an awesome, fun person and a fellow Brit like myself. But until next time, try not to troll too many net ones. We want to be here laughing when you do. Good night, everybody. Bye! Suck the blood out of your friends. Bye!